Are there variables for x, y, and z satisfying the system of inequalities shown here? Again, we have a system involving three variables, so it's going to be quite difficult to try to solve this graphically. But in a previous video, we saw how we could turn this system into a system involving only two variables by concentrating on one variable and see how it is related to the other variables. This time, we're going to look at the variable x. So we're going to focus our attention on x and write it in terms of y and z. And the first inequality will give a lower bound for x. And the second one, well, we want to isolate x, right? We want to make the coefficient of x equal to 1. So I'm going to first multiply both sides of the inequality by 1 half, and then bring everything that is not x to the right-hand side. So on the left, I will get x. On the right, well, 2 times a half is 1, and I'm going to get a half y and a half z. Now here, I have two inequalities with coefficient of x minus 1. So this will give me upper bound constraints for x. So I can write x to be at most minus 1 plus 2y plus z. And here I have x at most 1 minus y plus z. So now if we look at this system, we have lower bounds for x. In fact, two of them. X has to be at least minus y plus 2z, and x has to be at least 1 plus 1 half y plus 1 half z. And x has to be at most minus 1 plus 2y plus z, and x has to be at most 1 minus y plus z. So what this is saying is, if I look at any upper bound for x here, it has to be at least any one of these lower bounds here. And so, if x and y and z satisfy these inequalities, I must have the following. So the first upper bound has to be at least the first lower bound. The first upper bound has to be at least the second lower bound. The second upper bound has to be at least the first lower bound. And the second upper bound has to be at least the second upper bound. Okay. So now I have a system of inequalities involving y and z. If y and z come from a solution to the system up here, then they must satisfy the system. But we also know that if we can find y and z satisfying this system, then we'll be able to extend it to a solution to the system up here by choosing an appropriate value for x. Because these constraints down here enforce that all my upper bound constraints for x, all the upper bounds for x, has to be at least the lower bounds for x. So, these two systems are equivalent in the sense that if we solve one, we'll be able to solve the other. Alright, now this system here, involving y and z, can now be solved graphically, for example, if we want. But we are not going to do this graphically, we're going to do this algebraically. But before we do that, let me rewrite things a little bit. So I have two inequalities down here written as a less than equal to. But in my original system, everything is greater than equal to. I can turn these things back to greater than equal to, no problem, by just flipping the sign of everything. Alright, I have done nothing new. But now observe the following. If I label these inequalities as 1, 2, 3, and 4, this is now 3 plus 1, this is 3 plus 2, this is 4 plus 1, and this is 4 plus 2. What do I mean by adding inequalities? What I mean is, you add the left-hand side, the result is the left-hand side. And add the right-hand side, the result is the right-hand side. We can do that to form a new inequality because both inequalities have the same sense. Now, what is 3 plus 1? So if I just look at the system up here, 3 plus 1 is what? 3 plus 1 is simply 0 greater than or equal to 1 minus 3y plus z. And 3 plus 2 is 0 greater than or equal to 2 minus 3 over 2y minus 1 half z. 4 plus 1 is 0 greater than or equal to minus 1 plus z. And 4 plus 2 is 0 greater than or equal to 3 over 2y minus 1 over 2z. Okay, now let's simplify things over here just to see that, you know, the system in red is basically what we have over here in green. Alright, so what do we have here? Well, we have, if we insist on everything on the right hand side, then this is just minus 1 become 1 over on the other side. And this is minus 3y plus z, right? And the second one is, so we're going to 2 minus 3 over 2y minus 1 over 2z and 0 greater than equal to minus 1 plus z and 0 greater than equal to 3 over 2y minus 1 over 2z. And so you see they're same system. What I'm trying to say is combining the upper bound constraints and lower bound constraints is the same process as, well, you pair up inequalities involving positive x and negative x. Okay, so if you write all the inequalities with only x variable on the left hand side and everything is greater than or equal to inequality, basically, you need to, in order to form this system involving only y and z, for each inequality that has positive x coefficient, you pair up with an inequality with negative x coefficient. Add them, you get a new inequality. That's basically saying that the upper bound coming from an inequality that has negative coefficient for x is at least the lower bound coming from the inequality that has positive coefficient for x. Now, let's look at this red system. Well, this red system actually tells you a lot of things. Okay, so let me copy over this red system and work on it somewhere else. If this system has a solution, then the original system has a solution. Now, let me label these inequalities. Are there values for y and z satisfying these? If you add 6 and 8, okay, what do you get? If you add 6 and 8, you get 0 greater than or equal to 2 minus z. But 7 is 0 greater than or equal to minus 1 plus z. What happens if you add these two inequalities? Well, we get 0 greater than or equal to 1, which is absurd. So what this is telling us is there cannot be values for y and z satisfying these inequalities. If that had been possible, then we would be able to conclude that 0 is greater than or equal to 1. So, no values for y, z satisfy 5, 2, 8. Hence, no values for x, y, z satisfying 1, 2, 4 earlier. So, 1, 2, 4, remember, it's this system. Now, we can actually come up with a proof that indeed this original system has no solution. All right. In fact, we are just going to concentrate on this system 1 to 4 here. Remember, the contradiction that we got was 6 plus 7 plus 8. So 6 plus 7 plus 8 give me this impossible inequality. But then what is 6, 7, and 8? Well, 6 is 3 plus 2. 7 is 4 plus 1. 8 is 4 plus 2. So this is saying if you take 3 plus 2 plus 4 plus 1 plus 4 plus 2, we'll get 0 greater than or equal to 1. So simplifying this means that if we take 1 and then 2 times 2 and then 3, and then 2 times 4. We'll get 0 greater than or equal to 1. So we can check that, okay? If you take 1, and then 2 times 2, and then 3, and then 2 times 4, you get this contradiction. What if I want to do something like this? Instead of this system, 1, 2, 3, 4, I want to do something like this for the original system. Well, all you have to do is look at where you get 1, 2, 3, 4 from. Well, 1, 3, 4 are basically simple rewrite of the first, third, and fourth inequalities here. 2 is obtained by multiplying the second inequality by a half. So if you insist on writing this contradiction in terms of the original inequality, let me call this A, B, C, and D. The contradiction will be given by A plus. Now remember, I have 2 times 2, but 2 is a 1 half of B, so A times A plus B plus C plus 2 times D. And let's see what that gives us. Just to check, x plus 2x, 3x, 3x minus x is 2x, and then minus 2 times d, so minus 2x, so 0x. So y minus y, that's 0, and then 2y minus 2y, that's 0. Minus 2z minus z is minus 3z, plus z is minus 2z, and then plus 2z, that's 0. So on the left-hand side, we have 0. What about on the right-hand side? 0 plus 2 plus 1 minus 2. That's again 1. Impossible.